Great. Colleen?
The meeting tonight is for the conduct of town business by the town board. The public is invited to participate at the items marked on the agenda, public comment. During that segment of the meeting, if you have a question or comment for the supervisor, please raise your hand and wait to be acknowledged. Please state your full name and limit your remarks to 3 minutes. Thank you for your anticipated cooperation.
Thank you. Before we start the regular meeting, just want to let everybody know that we have a public hearing, and that's on local law of the year 2017, amending section 134-2 and 134-9 of the subdivision regulation within chapter 134 of the town code. So if anybody has anything to say about that law, I could just explain to you what basically it is. It's to speed up the process in the planning board. If somebody wanted to have a lot line change of two lots in the residential, they could do that without notifying the public, going through that whole thing. It eliminates like another step or consolidation. So that's what you could, the public hearing is about. And the resolution for the law to present the law was at the last meeting, and now it's to have the law be codified. That being said, I'd like to start the meeting off with the Pledge of Allegiance, please. Please remain standing for a moment of silence for all our brave men and women fighting all over the world for democracy and freedom, especially those in harm's way, and also for our men and women in blue. Thank you. Need a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion to approve minutes from the February 27, 2017 town board meeting. I have to abstain. It was on vacation.
I'll motion.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Authorized payment of bills, $140,348.14. I need a motion.
I'll make that motion.
I need a second.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any comments on the agenda? This is for the public. Okay, moving right along. And presentation. We have Cynthia Beham and John Beham. Cynthia, are you going up first, ladies first? On the master plan for the Milton Landing Park.
Having me tonight.
Thanks for coming.
Is it on?
Yes.
You're welcome.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you for coming.
So we're here to.
So I can get him on video.
Oh, okay. So we're here to discuss the park plans that were developed over the course of the last 9-10 months. First of all, we've been working with an advisory committee. I'd like to recognize, other than that, we will also go through the progress of our schedule. We'll review the site analysis part of our process and then present the park master plan. Funding and project support will come. Maybe John's gonna help me with that. And then we'll have some, open it up for some discussion. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you to this advisory committee, Gail Appler, James Appler, Alan Koenig, Alan Zetta, Tim Lawton, Daniel Pinavea, Rosemary Wine, and Jerry Mine. The many other volunteers who've been working on the park so far have done a wonderful job. These people have donated countless hours, so very much appreciated. This is where we are in terms of our progress. We're very close to the end. We've, you know, been through this process of meeting, getting information out, you know, talking and discussing with the committee of what their expectations are, what we like to call developing a vision for the park. We had a partner with Mazur who conducted a topographic survey for us that gave us scaled information so that we could work off it and develop the park plans. Then we did a concept design presentation in December and reviewed that with the committee, revised it with the committee's input, and have now prepared the final master plan for this presentation. So that's where we are in the process. Some other final aspects to complete the work are we've developed a cost estimate with our engineering partner, and we've developed the report, which is pretty far along in draft, but I didn't want to try to bring it tonight, and so that's pretty close for your review too. So the first step of our work is site analysis. These are some views showing the site. As you can see, there's there we go. So here's the Milton train station area and the waterfront park and land along the river. This is the upper part off
John,
Sands
excuse
Avenue.
Me. Over there, there's the light switches.
Sorry.
No problem. So the upper part here at Sands Avenue, which as you most, you probably all know, was a petroleum distribution site, which was acquired by the town. So it's a sort of a two-part park. Here's another view from the south looking north where you can see the train station in much greater detail. This has been an ongoing renovation project locally by volunteers. The building is beautiful inside and on the outside as well, but you know, this plan is to look at how to treat the exterior areas. But you can also see clearly the waterfront park, existing pier, and other piers that have been renovated along the waterfront here from this view. So then we go to a plan view, shows these areas with basic outline of the property boundaries. You can see up at Sands Avenue right here, entry, big, large open area. This is the area that has been developed or is considered, you know, for a dog park. This is a hillside slope, very steep in some areas, so the topography was very helpful in deciding how and we could traverse this area. This is Dock Road right here, and the sign, existing sign for Milton Landing Park is right here, and an entry to the hillside is here. Again, the train station, parking areas, and many of you are also familiar with this site, which was donated by Kedem Winery. This area has been also undergoing some demolition of pre-existing buildings and some restoration efforts, but it's got some open space, but is also quite enclosed by hillsides. Dock Road, very steep off the edge. Watson, this is all very steep here, and then another enclosing slope on the south side. So that's kind of some of your basic locational and site information. What we did then is take a more or less a quick analysis map where we say here's where we would come in off the dock, off Sands Avenue, have arrival, some type of gateway treatment here, have the large open area be somewhat like an open space. Our committee was interested in using the Poets Walk Park in Rhinebeck as a sort of a similar type of feel that they wanted to achieve here. So it's quite achievable. And then there's some hope to have overlooks and views out towards the river from the top of this mound over here that's existing. And so we'll probably be looking at some selective thinning along the trees in this slope. There also was a hope to get a northern loop trail that could come back and forth here and make the connection from here down to the Dock Road Park. Now in the Dock Road area, you have the same, trying to, you know, create an arrival gateway, which is already sort of there with the signage, but we'll just enhance that a bit. There's a through road, the Indian Trail Road, that goes through train station with keeping views open to the river, plans to eventually renovate the pier, and the committee has sought a new study to find out how much this would cost by Ty and Bond, who came in last October. So they're looking at the renovations for this pier so that a cruise ship might land here and bring people to the Marlboro area. This I already mentioned, large open and flat area eventually. Interestingly, there's a couple of old historic roads. This one that comes in off of the intersection of Watson, and this one on the south side that goes up to Maple. They're very nice old historic roads that exist there now, basically. So the main thing to remember is the two main areas of the park have been very recently disturbed, are in the process of renovation. So they're very much an open palette for park development, which is nice. So moving forward. I have it here, but it's not showing up there. Did I do something?
Where's your IT guy?
There he is.
It's on the bottom of the screen, not down here.
Yeah. A network error occurred.
It's not wireless, is it?
Okay.
It is. I explained it.
So what, a network error, was that? Output audio, restart application. Well, hold you all in suspense. Sorry. Is this because of the wireless?
It just disconnected.
Do you want to do it not by wireless?
Let's see if it connects.
Wireless from the computer to the machine.
What's it?
Can you see okay?
Sorry.
Okay.
It's got to. Is that right?
Yeah. That's the page that you're going with.
Mr. IT, huh?
Thank you, IT guy. So, as you've seen on the boards as you came in and on the graphic here, this is a master plan for these two park areas, what we'll really call one large park, which organizes it in a way that makes it very useful in the future. Accommodates the different uses that the committee sort of established and wanted to see accommodated here, and basically looks towards the future to look at the future areas that we can, what can be achieved here and how can we achieve them without being in too much conflict one use with another. So I'll walk you through this. First we'll start on the upper portion, or what's called northern portion. So as you come in off Sands Avenue, we'll put an entry sign in this area. We'll look to do some tree plantings in clusters to sort of have that feel of, some may have an agricultural hint to them, like apple trees or crab apple trees, something like that. And some will just have be tall trees to reflect that Poets Walk look. Then we're going to do the edge areas as wildflowers and perennials, and then have a central lawn that is an open area for different, low-key activities, maybe Frisbee or something like that. There will be some benches located along the, back. No. Sorry. John, help me. I don't know what I just did. I was just trying to use the pointer and it went back.
So much frustrating.
I was on that slide there.
Yeah.
I think I must have hit something else instead of the pointer. Yeah, sorry.
Is that okay?
Yep, right. Sorry. I won't use the pointer.
Just Two tokens.
All right, so I think we were down to the lawn, and I was trying to point out the benches that might be along the sides, along that path, which will be a nice stone dust path. And then we also are looking to develop an overlook seating area in this area. There's sort of a hill. We want to get people up to the top of the hill and create a nice little sitting and overlook area in that location. So here are some views from the Sands Avenue view looking east across the open space. You'll see the little hilltop type of pergola structure there. That would be where the overlook is. And then to the right side at the back would be where you have a pavilion for the arrival at the park. View two is a lookout from the overlook over the Hudson River. Something low like this that might have, you know, the trees cleared a little bit to get the view, and just a simple railing in a flat area. View three, not yet. Parking would be along this southern edge, nice and existing trees, nice and shady there, and in close enough proximity to the turnaround drop-off area, which is here. An area where you can pull around, drop people off, and go park. Then we've managed to find a way to create this loop path that the committee would like to see. There's some areas of traversing the topography through there that I think it would be very easy to establish that path. And then also the trail down to Dock Road, which has a little bit more steepness and would take a little more care in construction, but I think it would be feasible to do so. And it's much in progress, so I think it's quite possible. In this area, we're showing the dog park, which is mostly done at this point. There's a fence. The pergola has been built by volunteers of Boy Scouts, Eagle Scouts, I mean. And so in the future, we'll look to put some community gardens in this area and a picnic area alongside tables in that area so that, you know, people can bring in a picnic and sit there and, you know, work on their gardens. So here's the third view of that area, from like an aerial, a bird's eye, looking down and through at the dog park to the south. So now to look at the southern parcel, we have Watson Avenue at the top, up in here. And so right here, we're showing a little entrance here that follows the old road, the old historic road. We're talking about restoring a pond, which was located up over here prior for the mill buildings that were here, and creating a restored stream bed. There's a little concern that there is a lot of construction debris still in this area from the buildings that were removed. So, you know, in the restoration of the pond and stream, we could probably, you know, clear that up and create a good wide stream channel and achieve that as a nice aesthetic feature. On the other edge of this would be a open park area. So you arrive, come down, and there's a nice flat area. Might need a little retaining wall there, but this might be a gathering space where people, if you have festivals or music or something like that, where you could get people to sit and enjoy. A possible playground area over here. Possible additional parking in this area on grass right here. There was a lot of concern expressed for there to be adequate parking down here. A lot of use right now, and we'll, you know, be adding additional use. So we tried to find as many locations for parking as possible in that area. Considering in front of the train station area, we are thinking parking as pavers here. But also be looking to, you know, provide handicap accessible parking spaces there. So possible future, there might be a restroom. As the committee discussed, they would maybe consider adding restrooms onto this building, this existing sewer treatment plant building, to accommodate the future, future park users, as well as, you know, when the boats arrive here on the dock. So we'd like to think about the future and and provide some services like that. We would talk about moving the train shanty, it's a ticket shanty, and create it an arrival space here at the Gateway area, using it as a kiosk possibly, around and with a sitting area around it. And then, of course, you have the railroad crossing, which would need additional warning, signalization, and fencing. So that parking is about 40 spaces in the entire area down here. There's the area for the restored pier, arrival spaces, and paths, some shady sitting areas. This would be a kayak launch. And on to the north, maybe more of the quiet, passive park that's there now. So here's a view of this area. We'd just be talking about maybe pulling the grade out a little bit, an existing sign, and allows a little low wall with some steps to ease the grade and get people up onto the hillside path a little easier. This view from Watson Avenue, some type of a gateway feature here that leads people down a path and towards the train station and through this park and green space. And this view coming up from the train station area and looking across at the green space would be something like this. Basically, an open park area, this restored stream channel, the walkway up to the Dock Road Gateway, and what you can't see in this view is the pond that might be up above. So these were sketches from early. This is to illustrate the idea of how this might look on the existing building, adding a structure with some restrooms possibly. In front could be an area for the parking for buses. This is just a simple treatments along the trail edge going north, where most of these existing features would remain and we wouldn't look to do much in this area but provide access. So those are just some sketches. So now to talk about project funding. First of all, the tree planting grant recently submitted to New York State DEC, and one of our committee members, Rosemary Ween, and her husband Jerry helped to get that done, and so that's exciting. And you know, it's for some of the tree plantings that you see on this plan, as well as some for the Marlborough Hamlet area. There are other existing grants with matching funds through New York State Parks, and you know, some of that is already in hand, so it's a possibility that the money can be used for continued work on this park. The town has been very supportive, and volunteer efforts and donations have been a big part of what's happened here, so, and will probably continue to be. John, on the consolidated funding application, you want to talk about that? I don't know as much as you do about it, but there's a consolidated funding application that comes out and is due in June, so moving, you know, if this is a project that you want to move forward, you could just simply keep rolling right into, you know, securing or applying for those funds in June. There's other foundations, nonprofits that have been supportive here. Scenic Hudson has been a supporter in this area. We also have CSX, the New York State DOT, might help with some of the rail crossing issues. And other safety features that might be needed down in that area. Ulster County might be someone who might be helpful on the Dock Road bike and pedestrian improvements, or the, you know, revised alignment off to the side of Dock Road. So that's another possibility for finding support and funding for these projects. So other than that, that's the basics, if anyone has questions.
Any of the board have questions?
Where are you with the cost estimates?
Cost estimates are in. We have
okay.
done them. Yeah.
Okay.
They're fairly detailed right now. And so it's, how to put it exactly, there's a lot in there that is stated that you have done in the past as with volunteer efforts. So it's quantifying, it helps quantify what the volunteer efforts and some of the materials that are on the site are worth and have value. But so the numbers are in, I could go over them with you.
Okay. And then, so we're far enough along in terms of cost estimates to be in a real good position to go after grants, in your opinion, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yes. And that will help, you know, sort of identify what can be used as matching, you know, your match, because mm-hmm. there are materials here, there are volunteer efforts here, and those are quantified there in the cost estimate. So.
That's great. On one of your first couple of slides, you had where you had the demarcation line, and you had one of the lines, dotted lines, going out into the river.
Okay.
What did that signify?
Oh, there is actually property under the waters of the Hudson River. Part of that parcel is under the water.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, there were two demarcations. Which one is it? The one that's a little bit bigger than the...
I can go back to that if you'd like. Is it the little one?
Sort of your first or second slide, or early on in the...
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I have to go back through it all. But there is a pretty good portion of land under the Hudson River water.
It was the one by Mazur.
Yeah, yeah. But that's just showing, you know, where your property line is. And I imagine it went with that parcel because they had deep water docking there, right,
mm-hmm.
for the ships.
Okay, that's okay, Cindy.
I'm going back to slow.
This is really, really very nice. First I've seen this detailed presentation. Yeah. It's fantastic. I just
got
to...
So, Cindy, when you got cost estimates, are you saying you have cost estimates what this would cost, or
right
just
there.
The cost mm-hmm. of what's been put into it so far?
It's more or less saying what it will cost, but some of which is your own materials
right.
and future efforts.
So do you have those numbers to share with the board?
Not today.
Oh,
but
I don't think I brought them today.
You don't have a, do you have a ballpark on
did
it?
Did I bring them? Maybe I did.
And is it sort of, well, obviously it's phased, right?
Well, I'm just curious.
Yeah.
It still looks nice.
Great.
So you want
to
take
have
a
to
poll?
Pass them down. I didn't make multiple copies, so they're available, but not in multiple copies. So Howard, this is your question right here.
Mm-hmm.
This
and
part of the parcel that's under the water. Yeah.
That's owned. Okay.
Yep.
And Alan, how deep is that off of there?
It goes from 40 to about 65 feet deep at the end of the pier. It's
mm-hmm.
about 65 feet right there.
Amazing.
And we're not able to fill it. We've already talked to
right.
DEC. And
no.
They said no way, Jose.
No.
Any other questions from the board? Alan?
I'm good.
Ed?
Excuse me.
Whoa, Tom. Hold on, Tom.
Hold
on. Do you have any other questions?
No, I'm good.
So we don't know on the CFA what's coming out for availability on CFA yet? Anything,
no.
John? You don't know anything yet, right?
No.
Not until it's announced.
No, they don't really.
When that's coming out soon, though, right? They know?
Yeah.
I think in May.
In terms of what's in the governor's budget or how much is
well,
how
much,
much
would
is
be
available
for this type of funding, right? So the CFA is broad.
Lots
array
of different categories.
Of options. I mean, I wonder just how much is in it for
no
parks.
Yes.
And I know, like, a lot you had up there, Parks and Rec, a lot of times it's matching, right? So.
Can I help you with that, Scott? I think it's now is the time to start to apply.
You're right.
So our engineering partners put together those cost estimates
mm-hmm.
as best we could based on the level of design we have. And so there's kind of unit prices. And, so there's several sources. There's a few main ones. One is the one that provided funding already for the acquisition of parks, state parks. Right?
Two.
They also have funding for park development.
Right.
And so you're in good shape because the awards are worth it and quite a bit of parks. So sand, I believe, and that was all counted at market price for delivery of sand. And that was, quite a bit of money in terms of the park construction there.
So the donated fill that we got from the aqueduct drilling, we could use that? Or no?
We don't know.
Depends on the timeline or how.
That may be too late.
Yeah.
Can only go back so far.
They go back like this last LRP, they went back to April of 2015. Mm-hmm. So the new CFA, maybe they go back a year, we don't know. Mm-hmm. But right across from the train station, that park right there, we're in dialogue now with Parks and Rec because it's on life support, but I think we could get that going. We have $98,000 left from a grant that Mr. Coupart got back in the day to knock down those buildings. So there's still $98,000 left there. So we're in dialogue to get that going. So that would be a match because I think a lot of things were done by the highway superintendent there as far as water control and stuff, stormwater management. And Mr. Taylor did a bunch of stuff up there because of the storm. I guess it was Sandy. Mm-hmm. And so maybe those things will be a match. So we were talking about it. So see if that could come into play as a match with that $98,000. So I'm pretty confident that could happen.
But just so to answer your question, Scott, too, on the cost estimates you have, something like the number for topsoil that you see there, if the topsoil was instead donated, that number would be the match number and not a cost to you. It would be a match. So that runs through there for things like asphalt or stone dust or things like that. When you see numbers like that in the cost estimate book, we've talked about how you might, get those things achieved with the rock on the site, things like that. So the cost estimate might look high, but some of that will be either donated materials, donated services, things like that.
So. It's like almost what I expected. So
yes,
it's right there.
I think it's pretty
probably
realistic.
What we all expected.
It's really pretty realistic, and I was happy with it too that it came out about like that.
Alan, I wanted to ask
the estimated time and the completion of the project.
Well, it's funding based, of course, so it'll probably be phased through.
No, I mean for this part of the
plan
of the RFP.
Oh, well, we're almost done.
You're almost done.
Yeah,
so we'll be in time for the CFA and whatever comes out with
this
plan.
Yeah, I would say you'll have a final report within 2 weeks and basically be done.
That's strange.
Okay. Howard, would you?
I was going to ask, Alan, does any of this overlap with the other work that you're doing on the actual pier?
No.
There's a price tag for that. And
we're keeping both parties. Well, they're separate, but they're both in communication with each other. But they're two separate projects to be two separate cost analysts. So that's not included in here at all.
Right. So we're talking.
Two different grants.
And how close are you? You said we had the possible dirt donation. Are we close on that?
I spoke with him last week, and he said they're still building a pile, and they should be releasing it soon. And as soon as they release it, it's coming.
Yeah. And then there's a local pile that me and Tom have been working on that's up on by Reservoir Road, the clean fill.
Right,
so,
So that's good. So that
and
that
talking
can be
to Mr. Apple, that's he has no problem
moving it.
Yep. So we should be in pretty good shape.
With what's coming from where it's coming from, we're gonna have more than enough.
Yeah.
More
even
than
to
enough.
Do the park across
to do everything.
The train station.
Right? We need to do everything. It's gonna a lot coming, and it's free delivery.
Yeah.
So.
And that's all certified.
It's
and
New York. It's
off
New York
on.
State certified to actually grow vegetables in. Yeah. So it's
and you're going to get all the paperwork.
All the paperwork will come
with. Okay, thank you.
That's wonderful.
Okay, Tom, would you like to come up to the podium and
ask a question?
Oh, you stay there.
Stay there.
Would you come up and just state your name?
Yes, Tom.
Over here by the
microphone. I was wondering where the docks are, the void between the two. Was there a reason for that? Is it to allow boats to come in, or?
I think that the pier study showed some different layouts for boats arriving in this area. And so, this was where
There's, yeah, going on with the pier study, there's two visitors we're specifically working with that need to have modifications done to the existing dock in order for their boats to fit. One's a very, very large boat, and one's not so large of a boat. So we're accommodating them both. The piers were never connected together. We don't have any plans to connect them together. In the center, we would have, we'll talk about maybe putting out some modular type, low-level, like docking type structures, and a small kayak launch for ADA, so.
I have those drawings in my office, Tom, if you ever want to take a look at them. They're pretty good. Committee came up to basically have the Clearwater and the U.S. Columbia dock at our port. So the Clearwater is very important to the committee, and Gail Appert Jr. is very dedicated to having them especially come there because of the education value and what they bring to the community. And then Alan's been working with the U.S. Columbia, with the captain and people.
Yeah, the captain. And the SS Columbia is going to be, that'll sail from Manhattan, and it's going to be doing weekend tours. And they were going to be looking for deep water ports. It's a large ship. You can look it up online. They need deep water ports. That's going to be bringing up hundreds of people at a time. It's going to be, the final destination is going to be Kingston, but they need places to let people off. They don't want to bring 700 people to Kingston and say go. So we would be a landing location. We've worked with Ulster County already, tourism, for, you know, to do the transportations to get onto the local wineries, sell picks, that type of stuff. So.
And the other question I had was that Watson Avenue access, that's part of the property, or do we have to purchase something? Or?
No, that's pretty much part of the property.
The sidewalk coming down?
Thank you, Tom. James.
James Garofalo. Talked about putting pavers in this area, the train stations here, the main doors right there. And actually, these pavers should be put somewhere else because if this is where the accessible parking is going to go, people with canes and walkers and stuff might have problems with the pavers. So I would suggest putting them in one of the other areas.
I agree.
And having that stuff.
I agree.
We also had a discussion about possibly putting some kind of rack somewhere in this area for people to rent a place to put their kayak or trailer or whatever and chain it up. That's just another possibility of the way the town can make some revenue, and it would just be simple.
Thank you, James. Mark?
Could you share a little bit about the cost that Cynthia had given you guys?
No. They're preliminary numbers, and I really wouldn't like to, until we get it really concrete.
Well, I understand that because they talk about the grants or the possibilities.
Right. It's around $1 million.
Million's not what it used to be.
But again,
$1 million isn't $1 million hard dollars.
Yeah, and Mark,
service hours too.
And just looking at, this is the first time I've seen the list. Looking at the list, a lot of these items have already been included. Like, this is everything. This is as if we didn't get the rock. This is if we didn't get the topsoil. This is if we didn't
really
have planners.
That's really why I didn't want to make that statement.
It's an overall, but it's not a final from them saying this is what your park's going to cost you.
That's good.
That's not an accurate number of what the park's going to cost.
Because you mentioned
well, that's included. That's included into this price. It's
you could come up with $1 million.
We know we're going to get it, yeah. And the stone, there's a lot of, and like the planters. All these little things I'm seeing in here, we kind of already have. But they're just giving us a total of what's in it. So it's not realistic.
I can help you with point of reference. We thought about only giving just materials, you know, estimates. You know, this much square foot, this much cubic foot, et cetera. But for that point of matching the grant, you know, so if you decide to go after, you know, whatever sections.
Yeah.
It's documented. It's ready to go. Which was the value of the material, because that's what you have to do anyway, is document what it's worth to
over, that's...
Right.
It's on work, and the town can do that.
I mean, topsoil is 20% of that $1 million. It's 20% right there, it's not.
Yeah, that's why we just, you know, we separated it out, you can see it that way, but it's not like it's a total number for the cost of the park.
It's gonna look like $1 million, right?
It is gonna look like...
$2 million.
$2 million.
We get there.
Al, do you know what the goals were, like, square foot of the...
Well, I do know that the Sands Avenue and the waterfront is around 15 acres altogether, 15 point something.
That is, the one thing though is this area, that's how the Merhoni water is included. This area is about 4 acres, I just have to check that.
Yeah, I think in all inclusive, it's about 15 point something acres. That's what we bought from.
A lot of that acreage is steep slopes.
Yeah, that,
all that wood is...
That forest area.
Exactly.
We'll have to take you on that walk, Mark. It's quite impressive.
It's there. It needs work. We could do it. I'll meet you there Saturday. What do you think?
Maybe not this Saturday.
Maybe not this Saturday.
Too much snow.
Actually, bring your sleigh ride. We'll cross country skis instead of going out. Bring your sleigh.
Marshall, would you like to come up and just give us your name, please, and your question? Now, come up here, Marshall, so this way we can...
I know your first name, Doug.
I know you do. Me and Ed work.
Uh-oh.
Long time ago.
Galaxy.
Okay, let's go.
Is there going to be any consideration for possibly a swimming area for the town?
It didn't come up, I'll tell you that.
There's a little beach area down there. The problem, there's some issues with that, is that was a heavy industrial use site. So there's things in the water in there, and it's not really conducive to being... People do swim down there. I'm not going to say they don't. I see them. But it's...
Not necessarily in the Hudson. I mean, you got an area up there where you said you're going to be possibly putting a pond.
We already... Well, that's a...
You know, I don't see swimming in this.
That's going to be more like a frog pond.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not going to be...
I really don't see swimming here at all, Marshall.
Well, there is one other option.
Maybe Fred likes to swim a lot.
The city of...
Floating up something.
They're floating swimming pool.
Mm-hmm. Yep. In the river.
30 by 50 floating swimming pool or something?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think the city of Beacon waterfront's about 4 feet deep, and that's about 45 to 65. So there's a little bit. Yeah, but it's, you know, everything's a deep end.
Attached to the dock is what I'm trying to say. That area.
That would take away your boat.
The dead dock where there's dead space. Yeah, or can just a thought.
Well, thank you.
Thanks.
It's a thought. Appreciate it. Anybody else? Thank you, Marshall.
I used to swim there.
Okay. Thank you, Cynthia.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's fantastic. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, John, too, for IT support.
So, actually, there's a few members out in the audience that I want to acknowledge, and that's Rosemary and Jerry Wine and Gail Applewood Jr. Thank you for all your hard work on this project. And Councilman Koenig, big applause for Councilman Koenig. Okay, John, you're up next. You're going to just give us a little review of our LWRP. Where we are.
Good evening again, everyone. No PowerPoint to show you, so we're off the hook. I just want to kind of go look back a little bit about what we've accomplished and where we're headed. We're really pretty far along with the local waterfront program and plan. There's been draft kind of progress reports that have been submitted to the committee. The Department of State has them. We've been moving right along. We're on schedule for everything that we've been doing. And we had some great meetings. We had four, you know, kind of community planning forums that we had held. The most recent was with the agricultural community. We had a great session with those folks. A few really important ideas came up and issues came up, right? One being interesting, right, where the Hudson Valley Labs was brought up as a really, you know, kind of an important need. And you start to think about it, about research and that, you know, you think of any, you forget, and sometimes you might forget how technologically based agriculture is. You know, you know, being in an ag community, you guys know it, but, and new agriculture and new technology that's safer than the older stuff. And that's really what, it's one of the big needs. There's a few other things that came out of that. We had various meetings on economic revitalization, on the hamlets. We had meetings on housing and community services, right? The supervisor and I and Cindy Lanzetta went up to the high school, met with a couple of classes up there to get some of the young people and the students involved. They may be doing some survey work among the students. Right, I'm not sure the status of that, but they had hoped to do that. There, some of their higher classes to, you know, ask the kids about what they want to see in the future in the town. We want to make sure that that their voices are heard. And so, in terms of the board and the public, there's some upcoming meetings I want to kind of announce and let you know about. These are, stay tuned and make sure you check in with the town's website because the dates may change. But there's some upcoming committee meetings. One is going to be Thursday, March 30th, down at the train station. In terms of a public meeting, though, we have one coming up, our second public meeting, where we're going to be presenting a lot of the ideas that have come out of the committees. That's going to be April 20th. And that's the time and location of that is to be announced. Okay, we haven't decided where that's going to be yet. But stay tuned. But mark that date. I'll be back again in May to brief the town board on the results of that, and that'll be a little bit more, it'll be more detailed, and we'll have some of the kind of substance of the reports for you to look at. And that material will be available in advance, too, so you'll be ready for that. And then we're going to have another public meeting. The third public meeting will be tentatively on May 18th, and that's to present the preliminary draft comprehensive plan, the draft local waterfront revitalization program, and a waterfront consistency law, which really is a law that basically says for projects on the waterfront, are they consistent with the goals that the town has for the plan? And that's basically a requirement. We've got some more committee meetings. The committee's going to be busy. We thank you in advance for your time. You put in a time looking forward. In June 12th, we hope to be back at the town board to present the draft plan. Okay, and there's going to be a local environmental impact statement attached with it. And the environmental impact statement is not that there's necessarily going to be an adverse environmental impact, but since we're taking such a comprehensive look at the town, we thought, why not do a generic EIS so that you can cover that base as well. And then ideally, if the town's comfortable with everything, their June meeting, you would accept that as complete. You'd set a public hearing. Tentatively scheduled that for Monday, July 24th. We'll have to see if that date works. So everybody's summer, end of summers are tough. So like I said, these dates will, you know, these are not necessarily the dates, okay? These are targets and goals. And then August, in that kind of range, adopt the plan. That may move into September, depending on schedules. But we'd like to get the plan adopted and this year, as we said, and you know, keep it moving forward and these projects moving forward. There's a lot of projects that are kind of waiting for these grants and this funding. So that's what, you know, where we're all focused.
John, do you
questions?
Sure. You're right. That last meeting we had, the community meeting on agriculture, was very, Al were there, very good meeting. Do you think, we talked about CFA, do you think we'll have something we can use? I know we weren't not going to be finished with this whole thing by August,
right?
But will we have enough information and enough of a plan to pick and choose some things out of the LWRP exercise
so
we can start getting going? Yeah, okay. What everybody's...
Right. At our next committee meeting, we're going to kind of go over the projects, the long list, not that long, but the list of projects. Many of them won't surprise you because they've been kicking around, right? We're going to try to come up with that list, and as soon as that's done, we'll get that to you all.
Yep.
And then we can get ready to put those... be prepared for those grants. And so there's more projects than we have funding for, so we'll have to decide which
prioritize
the best. Yeah.
Yep. It's great.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mark, you got this from John? Okay. And already we, thanks to Rosemary and Cynthia Behan, we started the, we got the tree grant, so hopefully
yep.
we'll see how that.
Yeah, right.
We got that in just mm-hmm. in time, so.
Yeah, right, literally.
That's all that counts.
Right. Now it's, I can see it. I think you've got, and you've got a lot of that kind of, you know, with what Mr. Pollock is doing down in Milton, you've got a lot, you know, I think those kind of things really help, you know, to have those kind of opportunities where someone is investing private dollars and, you know, putting that money out there, and job creation type of thing, that all ties together. So things are moving forward really well. We appreciate your support and opportunity to, you know, partner with you and work with you and all the guidance you've given us. We appreciate it very much.
Were you surprised at the anything that came up at the last public meeting, the ag community meeting?
Well, I guess I was. I wasn't surprised that not everybody agreed. No, I think there's a lot of. It was a good conversation, you know, and there was a lot of support. I think. I have more questions than I have in terms of where, you know, get a feel for direction from that the farmers and farmland owners about, you know, their sense of things.
Right.
But there's a lot of support, I think, for what the town is doing. And you know, and I think one of the questions that was brought to them is how do we take the agricultural success that's happening and use that even more to revitalize the Hamlet centers, you
yes.
know, and so in that,
exactly.
I think that conversation will be bear a lot of fruit, if you
mm-hmm.
would.
Mm-hmm.
No pun intended.
No pun intended. I think it was intended. Very well
we
done.
Should end on that note, right? Out of room.
Quit while you're ahead.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, John. Appreciate it.
And these, we'll leave these are all for you guys to
That'd
keep.
Be great.
And you can,
yeah, nice. Keep them in
yeah,
your
the easels,
too.
Yeah, you can keep these.
Great.
If you want.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wait.
So I'm trying to cut our side out again? I'm probably never on the show.
Where's Alan? Okay, we're zooming in. Now the reports, and you got it, Scott? Okay. So, supervisor report for March 2017 had a meeting at Stout Ridge with Economic Development Subcommittee, Trail Committee. Had a meeting with Frank Bova about BC district requirements. Meeting with Adam Fedora about Eagle Scout project at Milton Landing. Attended Ulster County Supervisors meeting in Kingston. Attended Marble Planning Board meeting in February to discuss sign code. Attended LWRP meeting and public information session. Attended Marble Planning Board meeting in March. Meeting with Councilman Cerrone and, yeah, right.
Cerrone.
Oh, my own to me. Where did that come from? Meeting with Councilman Corcoran and
wow.
Mobile Life representative.
Wow, that's a big difference there.
I must have him on my mind. I'm sorry. I apologize, Scott.
At least they begin to see
I met with representatives of Meet Me in Marlboro. And I just want to remind everybody about this storm coming up that it seems like it's real and it's going to happen. So if you're... I don't know how it is to get out there, but if you're parking, if you're in the hamlet of Marlboro or Milton, you should go to the designated parking spots to get the cars off the road. So in Marlboro, it's the Presbyterian Church, and then in Milton, it's the new municipal parking lot across from St. James. And that's my report.
Al, what was the meeting with Mobile Life, you and Scott?
Scott had a question about how they bill, and so he explained to us how they do bill. Because one individual got a bill for
$1,000.
$1,000. So we wanted to know how do you formulate that? How do you get to that? And he explained it in detail.
Oh, okay. All
right. If it was anything else, he would be there.
I was just wondering.
Okay. Tom? Corcoran. There's
sure.
A lot of
That's
Toms in the room, but there's no Chris Cerrone.
Nope.
Sorry about that.
That's what I'm here to announce. I resign. Excuse me. Building Inspector's Monthly Report, month of February 2017. Certificate of Occupancy, 2. Request for Information, 10. Building Extensions, 1. Fire Inspections, 2. ZBA Applications, 2. Order to Remedy, 29. Complaints, 42. Burn Permits Issued, 15. Building Permits, 18. 2 furnaces, 5 demolitions, 1 tank installation, 1 pool, 1 shed, 1 clothing bin, 4 additions, 1 deck, 1 carport, 2 solar panels for an estimated cost of buildings, $149,596. Total monthly receipts, certificate of occupancy, 300, request for information, 1,000, building extensions, 100, building permits, $2,298.61, fire inspections, 80, ZBA escrow fees, 1,400, ZBA application fees, 600. Total monthly zoning fees, $2,000. Total monthly receipts for the building department, $5,778.61.
Any questions for Tom?
Reminder, burn ban will be in effect March 14th through May 15th. Ooh. So no burn permits for the
March
month.
March through May?
March through May.
March through May.
Tomorrow.
Correct.
Burn it tomorrow, huh?
And the answer to the question that most people ask, why, even though it's wet, it's raining, there's still snow on the ground. The reason is most of the dead brush sits on the ground at that time coming out of winter, and there's a larger opportunity for fire spread. So no burn permits till after May 16th.
And it's probably reduced the brush fire incidents in this town since its inception by about 95%. So it works.
Yeah, I haven't been to one in a long time.
Right.
How did you say that? Thank God.
Thank you.
That was it.
Thank you, Tom.
Thanks, Tom.
Chief. Glad to see you, Chief.
Yes.
All is well.
It is. Thank you. Let's see. Activity summary for the month of February 2017. Motor vehicle accidents, 7, which were personal injury. 0 fatals, 11 property damage, and 2 not requiring a report. For a total of 20 for the month. Summons is issued, vehicle and traffic 124 with 3 parking violations. Complaint activity, total blotter entries 308, total arrests for the month 23. Telephone calls handled 1,763. Police mileage 9,361 miles with a fuel consumption of 870.089 gallons. Questions, comments, concerns? Okay, for the dog control officer, Andrew McKee. We received a total of 13 calls this month, including 5 calls to service in the Marlboro Police Department, State Police, and Ulster County Sheriff. Responded to 4 active complaints and or cases which are now closed or resolved. We currently have 2 open cases that have been addressed but are ongoing and unresolved. We impounded 0 stray dogs. Appearance tickets were issued for this month on 6 town code violations and 5 agricultural and markets violations. We currently don't have any dogs in the impound. We've had no dog bites for the month. We have 1 case in Marble Justice Court this time. Andrew McKee.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jerry.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, Jerry.
Thank you. Alan, would you like to read Highway Superintendent Gail Appler's report, please?
All right. Monthly report for February 2017. Roads, we did coal patch patrols as needed. Due to the good weather, we were able to repair some lawn cuts. On 226, we had a windstorm that took down trees throughout the town. We chipped these up on 217 through 228. We screened the stone pile at the community garden and brought this all back to the yard. Trees and brush. We cut and chipped a down tree on Highland Avenue. We chipped up a large pile of Christmas trees at the landfill. Snow and ice. On 27, we had temps of 27 to 28 degrees and rain. We salted all roads and pre-treated black ice and schools had, and pre-treated. We had black ice and schools had a two-hour delay. On 29, we had 10 to 12 inches of snow and school was closed. We assisted the PD with sanding around two semi-trucks on 9W. On 211, we had a slight dusting to over an inch on the higher elevations. On 212, we had a forecast of rain and ended up with 12 inches in the higher elevations. On 214, we started at 5 a.m. and had a cleanup of Marlboro and Milton Hamlets. On 216 through 217, we had to push back all the intersections with our loaders. We pulled all of our sanders and did a midwinter maintenance on them, replacing bearings, adjusting chains, etc. Fuel usage, gas, 565.843 gallons. Diesel, 1,668.291 gallons. Respectfully submitted, Gail Appler, Senior Highway Superintendent.
Thank you, Alan.
Any questions?
Is he getting a full night's sleep tonight right now?
I would say those guys are all ready, and they're in bed and waiting a 1 a.m. phone call, I would imagine.
Yep.
I talked to them this morning.
They're ready.
They're ready.
Got their coffee ready to go.
So Charlie Maggio wasn't able to make it, but he did send in his report. Monthly report for February, water consumption total 10.3 million gallons, which is a daily usage of 368,000 compared to last month, 12.3 million gallons, which is a daily usage of 397,000. Compared to a year ago, water consumption was 11.7 million for the month, which is a daily usage of 405,000. Summary for the month, curb boxes, had to repair curb boxes, Green Tree Lane, South Road, and Route 9W in Milton. Meters, had to remove meters from houses on Purdy Avenue, South Street, Jackson Avenue, and Milton Turnpike. Bills went out at the beginning of the month. If there are any problems or questions that you have about the bill, feel free to give us a call. Also, if you believe that you have a leak or think that you have one, please call and we can help you find it. Sewer, had to repair sewer lid on Prospect Avenue, Dock Road, Brewster Street, and Western Avenue. Service line inspection, closings for markouts 10 gallons of gas, 310 gallons of diesel, 5 mileage for the month is 1300. And that's from Mr. Maggio. Thank you, Charlie.
Just one comment out. If anybody is interested in the work that's being done to repair the Delaware Aqueduct, there was a really good article, I thought, in Sunday's Middletown Record. I'm sorry, Mark, but I thought it was well done.
I read that. It's pretty good.
Yeah. So.
It's actually on the web, too.
Yeah. So.
Colleen, how are you? You all ready for the snow, Colleen?
No, I don't like the snow. I'm hoping they're wrong. You can only pray. Okay. Town clerk, monthly report, February 2017. Conservation, 1 for $1.21. Dog licenses, 28 for $155. Water services, 1 for $250. Transfer station permits, 6 for $390. Punch cards, 26 for $1,245. Marriage licenses, 2 for $35. Building department fees, 1 for $6,215.09. Fire fees, 1 for $440. Accident report, 17 for $95. Certified copies, 4 for $40. FOIA request, 1 for $20. Park fees, 2 for $300. For a grand total of $9,186.30.
Colleen, at the you have a correlation of how we're doing with the punch cards between last year at this time? And
I haven't checked, but it doesn't seem like it's too bad. I mean, I'm sure it's been, you know, significantly, slower, but people complain, but they still, you know, they still purchase them, so, but yeah.
Any questions for Colleen?
Nobody's ever happy, no, especially with me.
Colleen, appreciate it.
Yeah.
Moving right along. We have water quality management from Mr. Falco. March 13, 2017, report of water, Marble wastewater treatment plant for the month of February 2017. The average flow to the plant was 152,000 gallons per day. This was an average dry month and about 87% of design capacity, the capacity which is 175,000 GPD. The process is working well, meeting Speedy's requirements. Milton wastewater treatment plant. The average flow to the Milton plant during February 2017 was 32,000 gallons per day. This is about 58% of design capacity, 55,000 gallons per day. The process is working well, meeting Speedy's requirement. Overall, both wastewater treatment plants are in good working order. The collection system is being monitored and maintained by Charlie Maggio in the Water Department. And if you need any additional information, Board, please do not hesitate to contact Tony Falco. Thank you, Tony.
It's got to be a way I like to jazz this up, huh?
This old report.
All right. I think he just changed the date.
This plugs in the numbers.
Would you like to read the?
I think he changed
the date.
Sure.
Posted to the list.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah.
All right. This is March 11th report from Cindy Hilbert, Assessor's Office. Our office processed 17 real property transfers. We worked on 5 tax assessments. Our office continued to collect new construction and verifying the splits and mergers. This will continue throughout the month of March. We finished accepting the exemptions renewals. The filing deadline was March 1st, 2017. The data collector is continuing to his data collection verification of the residential properties within the town. He is currently working down in the Highland Avenue South Street area of the town. Submitted, Cindy Hilbert.
Thank you.
Assess.
Thank you, Scott. Howard?
Yep. Oh, boy. Okay, here we go. Planning Board review, March 13th, 2017. This is the meeting held February 21st, 2017 at the town hall. The attendees were Chris Brand, Manny Cauchy, Cindy Lanzetta, Joel LaFerro, and Joel Troncalli. Agenda items. First agenda item was Livera Properties on Route 9W. Applicant reappeared to discuss updated plans. Technical comments indicated the applicant should incorporate details for the proposed work within the DOT right-of-way. The applicant was advised to include details of site signage and dumpster enclosure in future final plans. The applicant previously held an on-site meeting with the town engineer, Pat Hines, members of the Marlboro Town Board, and the New York State DOT representatives. New York State DOT approval for the modified driveway location should be received. Ulster County Planning Board comments were received and include recommendations for signage, lighting, and access, including sidewalks. At the meeting, the applicant indicated the cost of installing sidewalks may be prohibitive. He was advised to consider the plan submitted to New York State DOT indicated sidewalks. Failure to install sidewalks could jeopardize his approval. The applicant was presented with numerous plans of action regarding sidewalk signage and lighting from the board and its attorney. The applicant plans to return for the March 20th meeting. Second on the agenda was Brian Bottini, 24 Chris Corner Drive, Marlboro, lot line revision. The applicant proposed a lot consolidation of 2 adjoining parcels, resulting in a combined lot area of 3.5 plus or minus acres. No new improvements are proposed on the property. The applicant was advised of the possibility of the town board passing legislation modifying the current requirements for lot consolidation with the town, what we're considering tonight. He agreed to adjourn until the second meeting in April, at which time it is presumed the town board will have made a determination about this resolution that's before us tonight. Third item on the agenda was Chestnut Petroleum, 1417 Route 9W, Marlboro. The applicant was not in attendance. A mailed request sought that their prior seeker
negative declaration be amended to include consideration regarding proposed signage as well as revisions to their highway improvement plan in order that they may proceed with pursuing variances for the Marlboro ZBA. A second amended negative declaration was proposed and passed unanimously. The applicant is expected to return at the March 6th meeting. Robert Pollack, Milton Hamlet, he was fourth on the agenda. Discussion without attorney, engineer, and or stenographer. The applicant presented a comprehensive plan of his vision for the region vitalizing the Milton Hamlet. Several new two-story structures were presented for the west side of the main street with commercial space on the first floor, rental space on the second floors. Plan also included a fluid performance space, park areas, and additional municipal parking. Mr. Pollack stressed these plans were only conceptual at the present time and urged the town to help him in any way it could. Notes, a dual meeting of the planning board and the town board is held immediately following the adjournment of the regular planning board meeting. The purpose of this meeting was to discuss the implementation of a new sign law for the town of Marlboro. The next deadline from this meeting is February 24th, 2017. Then I also have minutes from the meeting on March 6th. Attendees were Chris Brand, Manny Cauchy, Cindy Lanzetta, Joe LaFerra, Ben Trapani, Joel Tricali. Agenda. First was approval of the stenographic minutes for 2-6-2017. The approval for the above minutes were approved unanimously. Second item was Chestnut Petroleum, 1417 Route 9W. The applicant was not in attendance. A request was made via email that the planning board keep the public hearing open until March 20th, 2017 meeting. In the interim, the applicant will be seeking area variance for the signage from the Zoning Board of Appeals. The public hearing was opened and closed. Concerns raised included the lack of detail in proposed sidewalks, the placement of the height bar for the drive-through, native plantings for the site, and the ongoing traffic study. Second item on the agenda was timber harvesting Mount Zion Road. This was a sketch and site plan review. The applicant was advised their site plan application was incomplete, lacking many of the requirements listed under Section 141 of the Town Code regarding timber harvesting within the town of Marlboro. They were advised to complete the application in full and secure any necessary legal documents permitting him access to the harvest site via adjacent landowners. The third item on the agenda was Kevin Casey, subdivision site plan, discussion without attorney, engineer, and stenographer. The applicant sought advice on how to further proceed with subdividing property which had previously come before the planning board but not subdivided. He was advised to address the technical comments from the previous application and resubmit an updated map and application. The next item was MASDOC, site plan, discussion without attorney, engineer, and stenographer. The applicant indicated the site plan and special use permit applications were recently submitted and complete in addition to all necessary fees. The applicant was informed all submitted materials will be submitted to the town engineer and attorney for initial review. Next deadline, Friday, March 10th. Next scheduled meeting, Monday, March 20th. Respectfully submitted, Chris Brand, Chairman, Town of Marlboro Planning Board.
Thank you, Howard.
Yep.
Yeah. So, thank you. We have the public hearing about the local law. I need a motion to close that public hearing.
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
So moved. Next, report of committees, Recreation Committee.
Well, I could tell you I can't get a meeting with our Recreation Chairman. I've only asked him five times, so, Alan, I don't know what to do.
Tell him that.
Well,
don't ask him.
Did
tell
you
him.
Facebook him?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's Scott, easy. At this point, don't
I'm
ask him. Tell him we're having a meeting.
If they don't show up, then they don't show up. But I'm trying to get a date with him and Katie Bear for the concerts, and they won't get back to me with a date that they both can agree on, so I'm going to just make a date.
Text or call me tomorrow, make sure we both have the date open and set a date,
yep.
And that's the meeting.
Is Vinny still involved?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So, but we're trying to get ahead of the game
for the
concerts. And,
yeah. So do we don't have the same issue as we did last year.
And the year before.
You know.
I've been here.
You know.
And I also want to find out, a good discussion to have there too is for the race and all that too. We've got to talk about that. So.
Okay.
They got fit day.
I wanted to ask, did you guys get a note from a young man, the Boy Scouts, about a
yep.
Eagle Scout project, yes. Okay.
Yeah, he emailed me back today. He had his dates completely messed up.
Yeah.
So he's going to do it the 27th. He'll be here for a presentation.
Yeah. I explained to him the whole process, what he had to do, but I think he misunderstood. Yeah. He said his bad.
That's okay.
So he'll be in front of the town board at the next meeting.
That's a good idea.
Or the horseshoe pits.
Horseshoe, that's right.
Okay. Maybe I could assist you and see what I can do to get that meeting going.
I'll get him tomorrow again.
Okay.
He ain't going nowhere tomorrow.
Alan, anything on the Emergency Management Preparedness Committee?
Nothing as of this date, no.
All right. Just be prepared for this big snowstorm today.
Mm-hmm.
And the Conservation Advisory Committee finished their work on the solar code. I don't know if anybody had a chance to look at it. We've been involved with the sign code. I'd like to probably do that right after the sign code.
Yeah, let's get the sign code put to bed first.
So, and then I ask the board probably at the next meeting to go to attorney on that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, IT, thanks Scott and the IT committee. We got a whole bunch of stuff in today. And we're waiting for Colleen's computer.
Colleen's? It's really, every single day, it's
that's
a
the
problem.
Two things, the two computers and the printers didn't come today.
Yeah.
Of course.
They're going to be here tomorrow.
Yeah, they'll be here tomorrow, Colleen.
So
they don't drop
now.
Them outside.
No, every single day there's a problem with that one computer.
Tomorrow.
Every
yep.
day. Well, actually, as I was speaking to Al today, there was a problem. We had to reboot it.
You just texted me.
Can't even print.
I have...
it's coming.
No information on the Milton train station. Milton Landing citizens, I think we're moving along. We just had a discussion about the what we're doing down there with Cynthia Behan.
There's going to be a cleanup April 1st.
That's
a Saturday. So that's going to be our spring cleanup.
What
Sam?
Time?
What's that?
What time?
We usually do it about 8.
New York City.
7 to 8 o'clock in the morning start time.
9?
No.
8? Okay.
Start at 8. And that'll be for Sands Avenue and the lower.
On Sands Avenue.
And lower. Both
okay.
And lower.
Okay, thank you. Marlboro Hamlet Economic Development Committee.
Just the two things. One is the gateway, kind of we're waiting on the surveying.
Right.
And then the other is the trail, and we're waiting on the Tilcon meeting. So.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
I did call... Mr. Cooney up, and his secretary said that they haven't forgotten about us. He's been very busy, so.
Yeah.
Meet me in Marlboro. Met with Sheila today. She has a kickoff networking event, March 16th, mm-hmm. 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at Perch. So.
Are any of us going?
I am.
Okay. When is it?
I'd like to go.
Thursday.
Yeah, what time is it?
Try to go.
It's 6 o'clock.
Because it's 6 o'clock.
Can't get to it.
Six to 8.
Stop on the way home.
Okay.
All right.
Hamlet the Milton Association
6
Committee.
O'clock.
They're I spoke with Vivian and CJ. They're going to try to be at the next meeting to do a presentation. If not, they'll be at the April meeting to let you know about the May dates between
okay.
the cleanup and
so
the
I can put it
pop
on
party.
The agenda.
That's what I told her. Let me know. So yeah.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, you know me.
Yeah. Transfer Station Review Committee?
Nothing to report.
Okay.
Oh, I'm still... I need to get the team together, and I haven't, so...
Old business. Sale of Tomback Building?
Sold already.
Oh, that'd be great news.
Sold. Nothing.
Did you keep the cash?
Yeah. Under the table.
Municipal parking in the hamlets of Marlboro and Milton. Milton is, we're getting there. I mean, we have the municipal parking that we signed the lease for across from St. James. So that's a good thing.
Park there without fear of retribution?
Excuse me?
Can people park there now? Do we consider that a municipal parking lot?
Yeah. I have the signs that say municipal parking
lot. Okay.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
It's there.
Okay. It's there.
Okay.
Probably 20 cars could park there.
Do they?
No.
No.
We park in front of the firehouse.
No. It's too far to walk.
We need a subway right to the center of the city.
Escalator.
Well, you got the letter from the fire department, right? They're still parking there, right, Alan?
Yeah, that's right. Only when he's busy on the weekends.
So yeah, I saw that too.
Yeah.
So it's there. I mean, it's there for the people.
No, it's good.
It takes a while for people to understand.
And if the the Asian food
Asian
restaurant
Red Roof.
Red Roof.
I think it's gonna open
Red
this
Roof
week.
Takes
Red House,
off.
Look like you
I mean, it's not that far to walk.
Red House. Now, people look for parking spots when they drive to the walkway. They're there to walk over the bridge, and they try to park at the closest, like it's like their Christmas shopping.
I understand. I understand.
It's ridiculous.
It's there. If anybody wants to park there, it's there. Municipal parking.
It's there.
I sent correspondence from Dennis Larios on the Milton Sewer expansion about him doing the boring, and Bayside project is moving along. We're going to have a meeting with Mr. Sessman and Joe DiPico and Justin and myself and Scott Corcoran. I forget the date.
23rd.
23rd?
23rd.
Yeah.
1 o'clock.
Yep. Up at school. Middle school.
At the middle school. At the
middle
site.
School.
And the purpose of that meeting is?
And with Michael Brooks.
This is for the school district's request,
right.
Because in the new
FEIS,
all the requests that they had given are not in there anymore. So we want to find out if there's something we could do to facilitate getting better parking at the middle school.
So their last request from the middle school was not addressed at all?
No, it wasn't addressed at all.
It was omitted from the FEIS, and along with that, the original parking that they were going to was also
eliminated.
So at this point, the only thing they were saying is they would give 0.15 acres, I believe, Al?
Yep.
Of property to the school district to create their own parking. So we want to have a meeting there with them on site and see if we could get something that will be a little more better for the school district and for the town. So that's what that's the purpose of it.
Okay.
So.
And the signed zoning changes, we're almost there. You're going to meet.
Scott and I are going to try to hammer this out on next Wednesday.
Okay,
second,
put the boxing gloves on.
Thing,
okay. I think you're almost there. I read some of the stuff that Scott put out.
We'll get there.
Milton Train Station grant for the exterior. Actually got a call for a couple of items that they said that were missing, like the SHPO report and CECRA.
The one that you sent them 3 months ago?
The one I sent them 3 months ago. So I resent it, and hopefully we'll be back on track with that bureaucracy up there. And we just heard from John Behan on the LWRP. I put down in new business, I put the grant writer for economic development. Actually, I call Robert up, and I agree with Alan. You know, he's not going to wait for a grant to do whatever Robert's going to do. But I was surprised to hear from him that, you know, he would like to talk to at least another grant writer. So I called Mark Blauer up, who represented the towns way back when.
Yep.
It's very used. I trust Mark. He's honest. So I have a meeting with Mark and Robert on Thursday.
What are his rates? I mean, is he?
That's what we're going to discuss.
Yeah.
Like Scott says, sometimes they go on a percentage of what they bring. You know.
I mean, just not that I'm anti-business, but at all, I'm not anti-business. But shouldn't a business owner pay for the grant writer?
Well, if he gets a grant, he's going to pay most of it anyhow, right? It's just the grant writing that might be involved with the town.
Yeah.
I'm just going out and looking at it as, you know, let me do the research like Scott wrote, see what it costs, come back to the board, see if the board, wouldn't be just for Robert.
No, I mean, if it was for Tony,
Falcon,
or
somebody
Perch,
that
whoever, yeah, I'm just saying, but usually the business owner.
No, I think we ought to expand. I mean, look, we're right at the point where when the CFA opens up, there's a lot of things we should be going for. This is the time to get a grant writer. I mean, beyond Mr. Pollack or Mr. Falco.
It's true.
So if we can, we got a lot of things stacked up here that we need to get money for.
Let's find out.
We're in a good position, I think, to.
Yeah, I mean,
we're
going to
be competing
against
ourselves.
I mean, we have enough plans to.
Yeah, we've got enough plans.
I think we've got enough plans to put
in
100 applications.
I mean, we could all come up with 10 things.
We've got ideas and plans.
And this presentation we had tonight, it's got.
look at this. I mean, it's got drawings, it's got estimates, all the stuff you need for a grant. Just cut and paste, put it in there, get it done.
So I'll report back to the board, Al, and let you know what the cost is. And even if maybe you're free at that time, maybe you'd like to join me?
Yeah, I'd love to.
I mean, maybe we ought to look at Mr. Behan writing some of these grants. He's got all the background.
We had, well, we've done that in the past. That's past practice where we had B&L do a couple.
Yeah, they wrote, that's why we got the LWRP. They wrote that grant.
Yeah.
That's why we got the Route 9W study. They wrote that grant.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So usually it's, you know, we've had our planners handle that. But let's meet with the gentleman. Let's go. All right, moving on.
I mean,
I'll let you know when that date is, Al.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, he's right. No ups, ups. Bring him up to speed.
Correspondence. I think I have these guys are having fun, too much fun.
We're upbeat. We're making it upbeat.
So I got a request, I think, Colleen, you saw this, right, from Kevin Kahn?
Yes.
About the girls' softball. He's asking for a lot of dates
Kevin
here.
Kahn,
all the dates so far, except for two. The one is a Bounty Fest rain date, and another one is a postpartum. And they might
What's
be using it.
Softball
so
game?
If you're okay, we're all right with all the dates team. Except for two.
And it doesn't have any problems?
Softball program.
No, we checked with Rick and Ricky Schmelt.
There's no conflicts
okay.
with the other guys?
He said
with
no.
all those dates?
Ricky said no.
Yeah, because Kevin said he was in talk with
now,
Daniel.
He
just
talked
to
with Ricky.
Follow up, how did your meeting go? Did you get to meet them again?
No,
week?
It was too cold.
Too cold?
It's too cold. It was so
it was
underground,
cold.
You couldn't see anything.
So,
so
I mean,
Dale said he would meet us, but it was just
too
cold.
Cold.
You couldn't do anything. You couldn't see
what,
anything.
For the drainage?
We were going to meet with the baseball people.
I mean,
and Gail and Dave.
Tom knows, right?
Up there at the baseball field, and Tom Corcoran, but it was too cold Saturday, 12 o'clock. Couldn't see anything. So, just to follow up, this is good? This is good for Colin?
Everything but two dates are
Kevin
fine Carr? With us.
So tell him he gave you the two dates.
Okay.
It's a big job.
So as long as it's fine with you, we'll call him and tell him it's okay.
Okay. And everybody saw the letter from Justin Pascal about the Marlboro Town Police Prevent. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And we got a Milton Fire District from John McGrath, Chairman of Milton Fire District, and he just, to whom it may concern, we, the commissioners of the Milton Fire District, respectfully informally ask that the parking regulation on Main Street in Milton be enforced with special regard to the spaces affecting the Milton Firehouse and responding apparatus. The officers and commissioners have made a number of requests over the past several months. However, parking continues to be an issue. Is it an issue?
It's a huge issue.
Yeah, okay.
Jerry, come on.
So people are...
It's,
we've been
yeah.
down there.
They have
we
been...
We don't
in,
see
yeah.
it. But Alan just told me that
yeah.
mostly Saturday and Sundays around lunchtime.
Around brunch.
Brunch, I'm
yeah,
sorry.
Around
so
brunch.
We'll do that. I'll make sure weekend patrols go down there and pay attention
right.
and do something about that.
Okay.
Now, every time they've made a complaint, and they have complained quite a few times, this is exactly what I do, is I send patrol down there for specific missions. Just didn't really ever found anything.
Yeah, and one of Jerry's officers stopped at the firehouse to see me. He says, hey, he says, I'm, a guy said, why are you buzzing up and down the street? You know what I mean? He was up and down like five times. He says, well, we're patrolling for the parking. When is it? He says, I've never seen.
Yeah.
I said, it's on the weekends.
Okay,
but
so we're
going to
address that.
Yep, we're going to look at it this
okay.
weekend and the next 2 weeks. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. Any public comments? James?
Oh, yeah. 2 minutes.
Who wants to start getting comments on the emails on the sign ordinance? Raise your hand.
I'll take the, you can give them to me.
Okay.
And I'll distribute them to Scott. You can copy Scott and Howard also on it.
Okay.
Why don't you send it to the whole board?
All right.
The whole board.
Yeah. I'll send it to the whole board. Second thing, and last thing, is, you know, we've had some problems with the clearing the sidewalks of snow. We know what's coming tomorrow. You know, you may want to think about what you're going to do. You know, you've already sent letters out.
We're going to put a plow.
I'm not going to do any of that.
It's
my driveway to worry about.
You've got dumps thrown.
Don't
have it. Don't worry about
it. So you can expect, I'm sure there's going to be a problem. So I just wanted to bring that up again because we know it's going to be an issue.
It's going to take a couple of days.
It's going to be a tough cleanup.
A lot of people have been very, people went out and got snow blowers, business people. So I expect it's going to be a while before we get those sidewalks cleared.
It'll be a while before you can even get enforcement out there to look at it.
It'll be a while before I come down off of Reservoir Road.
Just to throw this out there while James brought that up, a friend of mine's fire department got fined by the town that they were in for not plowing their sidewalks. So that shows some towns how serious these towns are.
Of course
they do. They $200, they fined the fire department.
The city of Poughkeepsie has some serious ones, I can tell you that. Yeah. If you don't clear your sidewalks there, you're fined within hours.
Yeah. I can tell you Brooklyn's the same way.
And I agree with you, but we discussed fines, right, Tom?
No, I'm just saying, we were trying to tiptoe around it and be like,
really
these
not
towns
that
just hammering.
Well, you know, I'm getting some, you know, I've even sent a letter to the school because they had that sidewalk.
I know, they didn't do theirs.
And they have to do theirs, too. They
now,
seem like to laugh me off.
The agreement that I heard of for the Milton Turnpike sidewalk is when the county put that in, that the school district is responsible for clearing the snow off that sidewalk. So that's something to look into. There's an agreement between the school district and county highway. And when the school district requested that sidewalk, that county highway said, we'll put it in, but we're not maintaining it for snow. So you might want to look that up.
Okay.
The one on Young Avenue a few years ago, they were not clearing. I talked to them. Now they clear it fine. They do a very good job. And also want to thank the board for empowering the planning department with this new law to save people money on their lot line consolidations. Thank you.
Mickey, come on up.
Oh, Mark, you just stepped first.
How are you?
Good, how
are you?
Good. Mickey Simonofsky, Marlboro, New York. I just want to congratulate the board for the choice of Behan Consulting. I think that they have done a fantastic job with all of the work that they've been doing the past year. I have personally attended four out of five public hearings that they've had. They've been very well attended, very well received, and such a professional, well thought out, well developed presentation for each of those different areas. I went to the ag meeting the other night, and I thought that was just so heartwarming to find members of our community so forthcoming in their ideas, comments, cooperation, and it really feels very, very good that the town is moving forward this way. So I want to congratulate you on Mr. Behan, and I want to thank them in absence, but I want to thank them for their professionalism and how they have developed everything to make it intentionally, they've made it easier for the town board to move forward. I hope you get a lot of those grants, and it's phenomenal. It's just phenomenal to see everything working out so very well for the town. So I thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You don't get much of those. It's nice to hear once.
The data
board. Mark.
I just wanted to follow up. Previously, the board had talked about getting a second opinion on the sign issue. And did you get one? And what was that opinion about?
You mean on the legal issue?
Right. You said you were getting a second opinion.
Yeah, we did get a second opinion. I feel uncomfortable talking about that right now. If you want to come to my office, we could discuss it. But I think that's client lawyer privilege type of stuff.
Well, the first opinion wasn't.
Huh?
The first opinion wasn't. The first opinion was public.
The second opinion, I just, to me, I'm uncomfortable with it. If you want, the board wants me to release that, that's fine.
Well, the first one was released, that's what I'm saying. So I don't.
The first one was sent to the board. It wasn't basically released to the public.
Well,
Mark got it.
It was in the newspaper.
Did you get it?
Yeah. Mark got it. That's a little more than the public. That's the case.
Well, I can tell you this. The opinion was twofold.
The lawyer didn't agree with the first statement that Tom Corcoran had to go and get a resolution from the board, the town board, to summons a fine or a fee, whatever, right?
To move forward with a violation of code enforcement.
Yeah, right. So she
didn't do his job.
The lawyer didn't agree with the first part of Mr. Blass's statement.
Right.
She did agree with the second part, which of the signs being all non-conforming and that we don't have to go and issue fines for those people right. that are non-conforming.
Okay, right. And that's about the gist of it?
That's it.
Okay, great.
But I would say, if I gave it to another lawyer, it might be all different.
If you gave it to three lawyers, you'd get three different opinions.
Yeah.
They're
paid. Well, I got two, so I'm going to stop from there. I don't want to spend no more money.
I would say that was a good opinion. I mean,
yeah.
First thing is, look, the code enforcer's got to be able to do his job.
Right.
Right? And secondly, you're not going to go back and fine everybody for
right.
past practice that was accepted already.
So we agreed on that.
Okay, great. Thanks.
And if you want, you could come to my office and I'll give you the second letter.
Okay.
Resolutions? Okay. Okay.
I don't know exactly where.
So, resolution 42 to oppose construction of the Pilgrim Pipeline. Supervisor Al Lanzetta proposes the following. Whereas Pilgrim Pipeline Holding LLC is proposing to build a bi-directional pipeline in close proximity to the New York State Thruway through Rockland, Orange, Ulster, Green, and Albany counties and in New Jersey. That would transport crude oil and refined petroleum products between Albany, New York, and Linden, New Jersey. And whereas a lateral offshoot from the proposed Pilgrim Pipeline is planned to travel east from New York State through a right of way to Buckeye Roaston Terminal to carry refined petroleum products. And whereas the Roaston Product Lateral, the RPL, will permanently impact orchards and lands that it crosses in the town of Marlborough. And then, whereas the town of Marlborough and town of Newburgh are contracted with New York Department of Environmental Protection to receive public drinking water from the Delaware Tap and Filtration Plant located on Latintown Road on the town border of Marlborough and Newburgh. And whereas the RPL will cross land within 200 feet of the shaft that supplies the drinking water for the town of Marlborough and Newburgh. And whereas any rupture or compromise of the proposed pipeline lateral, even without an explosion or fire, will require extraordinary cleanup efforts, endanger the public water supply of the people of Marlborough and Newburgh. And whereas the town of Marlborough backup supply of public water is Chadwick Lake in the town of Newburgh. And whereas the town of Newburgh has passed a resolution regarding the Pilgrim Pipeline on June 1st, 2015, stating its concerns of possible contamination of Chadwick Lake by the close proximity of the lateral to its backup water supply. And whereas, due to the uncertainty regarding the aqueduct adequacy of safety measures to prevent leaks and ruptures of the pipeline, the town board of the town of Marlborough finds that the proposed Pilgrim Pipeline and its laterals routing through the town of Marlborough and Newburgh potentially threatens the health, safety, and welfare of the community, and also would decrease the value of homes located along its routes and limit the agricultural visibility of the use of land and existing orchards. Therefore, it be resolved that the town, Marlborough Town Board calls upon the New York State Thruway Authority to reject use of the right-of-way for Pilgrim Pipeline and further calls upon the New York State Department of Transportation, DOT, to deny any exception to its accommodation plan for said proposal. And it be further resolved that the Town Board of Marlborough urges Governor Cuomo and the state legislature to oppose construction of the Pilgrim Pipeline and its lateral along the current proposed routes to the Town of Marlborough and the Town of Newburgh. And directs copies of this resolution be forwarded to pertinent agencies and elected representatives of the state of New York. And moves for adoption.
Councilman Corcoran.
Yes.
Councilman Molinelli.
Yes.
Councilman Koenig.
No.
Councilman Baker.
Yes.
Supervisor Lanzetta.
Yes. This is Resolution 43. This is the secret for the section of 134-2 and 34-9. And basically, it's a neg deck. So I'm not going to read the whole thing. We're familiar with these. I'll just go to the... So I think the board's familiar with this. It's a neck deck on the local law of the Town of Marlborough, Ulster County, New York, amending section 134-2 and 134-9 of the subdivision regulations within chapter 134 of the town code to address lot consolidation and lot line realignments for no more than two lots in the R and R1 and R Ag 1 zoning district. Could you poll the board on that, please?
Sure. Supervisor Lanzetta.
Yes.
Councilman Molinelli.
Yes.
Councilman Corcoran.
Yes.
Councilman Baker.
Yes.
Councilman Koenig.
No.
Okay. So now this is the adoption of the law. And I just stated what the law was about through the secret. And could you poll the board?
Supervisor Lanzetta.
Yes.
Councilman Molinelli.
Yes.
Councilman Corcoran.
Yes.
Councilman Baker.
Yes.
Councilman Koenig.
No.
Three strikes are out.
That's three in a row.
That's a record.
That's a record. He was a pretty agreeable guy. The whole thing with the pipeline, it's almost the safest way. I'm against it on the river. The rails aren't all that safe. It's not the best. It's not good, but it's got to get there somehow. We all drove cars here today. You know what I mean?
I know what you're saying.
I don't mind that. I just don't like that it's 200 feet from our water supply. And the water supply is drinking water for the town. Yeah. And plus, we don't see one drop of that oil.
Exactly.
It's getting shipped to Jersey, and it's going shipped overseas.
It's keeping our price down.
So we're not getting one drop of it.
You might need it. You want to get off oil altogether. You want to see barges in a river.
They're going to be, barges in the river, filling them up with that oil and taking them to somewhere else.
They do that now.
We're parking them in the river now.
So,
it's a tough one, that's for sure.
Okay.
I call for...
Do you have any more dialogue on any of this?
Sure, man. End the meeting before the snow begins.
All right, so I need a
motion. To close the meeting.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all. Stay safe. Hey, John. How are you?
Hey, Jerry. How you doing, buddy?